Let's pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful day. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuild and bind every foul picket of the spirits. We're going to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have recourse in the midst of us. We thank you, Lord, that you alone are our inheritance, our cup of blessing. You guard all this ours, and we know, Lord, you're always with us, and we're not going to be shaken, Lord, because you are with us, and no wonder our heart is glad, and we can rejoice and rest in safety. We come this moment to hear your word and refresh us with your word. In Jesus' most precious name, and all the people say. Today, I want to share with you, continue our series on kingdom inheritance, that how you can experience and walk to your destiny. You have a great destiny, a very unique destiny. How you can inherit and walk in your destiny in style. In other words, truly enjoying the whole journey. Like what the clip tells us, experiencing heaven and earth, heavenly power on this earth. But too many people are very frustrated, they're very stressed in the Lord because they have this thinking, if it is going to be, it's up to me. So I have to slot, I have to do this, I got to do that, I got to fend, I got to defend, and I got to pull string and push around and, you know, I got to raise voice and do this and do that. And as a result, they got stressed and they get frustrated. Hey friend, God wants us to enjoy our journey because Christ said, blessed. That word in Greek means happiness. God wants you to be happy. Makarion in Greek means to be happy. Not just to be blessed. God wants you to be blessed and be blessed happy. And we continue our study. See, another powerful grace channels. These are not laws. These are not principles. But channels whereby God can release His anointing, His heavenly power in our life. We can enjoy our journey, all right, to fulfill the amazing destiny God has for us. Matthew 5:5.
Blessed are the gentle, for they shall inherit the earth.
What is the meaning of the word gentleness? Well, in the Greek it says there, meek, humble, mild, soothing, tender, friendly, courteous, kind, and considerate. And I put there, a person who is gentle does not overreact. He was not driven by emotion, isn't moody, pushy, mean, rude, fierce, nor abrasive. And by the way, gentleness is not weakness. The world has it. Man, if it is gentle, it's like a whim. Very it's a pushover. No, man, gentleness, the Bible tells us, actually is strength under control. It comes from a picture of a horse that has been tamed. You know, the horse that has been trained, those amazing race horses, they are as strong as the wild stallion. But you know what? They're able to be used by their master because it's been trained, it's been tamed. So, some of us know that when our strength is under control and we're able to be gentle, the Bible tells us it releases astounding, amazing power in our everyday life. Number one, gentleness disarms your adversary. Hey, when you have a gentle spirit, you can actually neutralize the power of your enemy. Look at Proverbs 25:15.
Through patience, a ruler can be persuaded, and a gentle tongue can break a bone.
Wow, a gentle tongue is so powerful, can it actually break bones? That is amazing and astounding, all right? In the Bible, I can think of a king, his name was Rehoboam. Rehoboam just inherited his kingdom, his green. So he asked his elders, hey, how should I govern this country? The elders said, yeah, you got to be gentle, you got to be nice, you got to be kind, these people will serve you forever. But instead, he listened to his friends. It doesn't have much wisdom. And the friends say, man, you got to be harsh. You got to be hot, man. Otherwise, they're going to listen. You got to raise your voice. You got to show your face and people will listen to you. And so Rehoboam went to the people that came to him and say, hey, you think my father is very hard on you? I'm going to be harder. You think my father is very harsh on you? I'm going to be harsher. And you know what? As a result, Rehoboam lost 8/10 of his kingdom. More than 8/10. And on the other hand, there's another ruler. His name is Abraham Lincoln. United States has gone through a devastating civil war. And how did Abraham Lincoln manage to unite the country after a devastating war? Well, one thing I was told, Abraham Lincoln was very gentle and kind to the defeated Southern states. And because of that, he united the entire nation, despite of the devastating war, and thousands of people die. So Abraham must know that gentleness releases tremendous power. Look at a passage in Proverbs 15:1.
A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger.
A gentle answer turns away wrath. She's so gentle. When I say something, she's paused. He didn't fight. You know, Hammer must know, a gentle answer turns away wrath. When people raise their voice, the natural human tendency here can raise voice, I raise louder. He talks about me, I talk 100 thing about him. Hey, the Bible tells us a gentle answer turns away wrath. Even police studies from psychologists from the police force said, hey, the key way to diffuse a very tense situation, everybody's speaking loud, is to lower your voice. And that diffuses the situation. So gentleness is powerful. It actually neutralizes the power of the enemy. Number two, gentleness helps manage your feelings. Proverbs 25, verse 28.
A person without self-control is like a city with broken down walls.
Put it this way, the Bible tells us your feelings. If your life is run and controlled by feelings, do you know that your number one enemy is your feelings? Number one enemy. You know, there's 2 million people lost inheritance because they were controlled by their feelings. Instead of being controlled by the Word of God, the promises that God had given to them, they were controlled by that feeling on inside. They felt so intimidated, they felt so much frozen in fear, they lost their amazing inheritance. 2 million of them. So your number one enemy is not your mother in grace, is the feeling on the inside of you. Look at Proverbs 29, verse 11.
A fool vents all his feelings, but a wise man holds them back.
If your life is always driven by feelings, if what you say is always controlled by what do you feel on the inside of you, feeling, nothing but the feeling. Everything is controlled by feeling. And what you do is controlled by your feeling. What you buy is also controlled by your feeling. You're going to have a lot of signs and wonders. You sign your checks at the end of the month, wondering where the money could come. If your life, what you say, what you do, what you buy, is always by impulse, driven by feeling, you're going to be in big trouble. Put it this way, you cannot get rid of your feeling. All right? We cannot do away with the feeling on the inside of us, but we can, the Bible tells us, manage, control our feeling. Take a passage in Proverbs 12, verse 16.
A fool is quick-tempered, but a wise man stays calm when insulted.
And you're wise, you learn to stay calm. You cannot take away your feeling, but you can control it. Just like people say, you cannot stop or prevent a bird from flying across your head, but it can prevent that bird from building a nest on your head. So the thing is, learning to manage our emotion. The Bible tells us also in 1 Corinthians 4, verse 13.
We appeal gently when evil things are said about us.
When even evil things are said or done on us, Bible tells us we appeal in a very gentle way. In other words, God says, decide ahead of you. No matter what people say, whatever you do, you are going to control your reaction. You know this guy, his name is Viktor Frank, a very famous psychologist. He was being imprisoned by the Nazis during the Second World War in a very horrific place, Auschwitz. And they took away his clothing, took away his wedding ring, took away his children, took away his wife. Stuck naked. And in that awful condition, he received an amazing revelation in life. We're going to learn that, yeah, these people can take away my clothing, can take away my ring, wedding ring, can take away my wife, take away my children. But one thing they cannot take away from me is my freedom to choose my reaction. And I chose to be at rest. And studies have shown that those people that survive for those concentration camps are those that chose to react the right way. The key thing is you cannot take away your emotion, you cannot get rid of it, you can manage it. You know, you cannot control what people say, no matter how kind you are to them. You cannot control what people do, but what you can control is that you can control your reaction. In your notes, I put it down, don't let people control your life by making you hate them. So pastor, that guy in the office did that nasty thing. He made me mad. Pastor, my husband made me mad. Yeah, put it this way. If, humorous though, when you can be made mad by what people do, huh, people say, you actually acknowledge that you're under control by that person, that is a sign of weakness. All your focus is, oh, Pastor, I got to fend for myself. I got to defend for myself. I got to set the record straight. You got to end up very miserable, very frustrated. Some of us know the better way is to be at rest. Otherwise, you're going to lose your peace, lose your happiness. So gentleness helps us manage our emotions. The Bible tells us a fool is quick-tempered, but a wise person stays calm. In other words, you choose to be calm because you know you're wise. And other people say, amen. Number three, gentleness makes you persuasive and influential. How would I like to be influential and persuasive? All right, Proverbs 16 verse 21 tells us,
the wise are known for their understanding, and pleasant words are persuasive.
Gentle words are persuasive. I think it was Rick Warren to say that I am never persuasive when I am abrasive. How many of us know that being harsh, being hard, is self-defeating? How many of you want to be influential, persuasive in your relationship, perhaps with your spouse, with your children? The key thing is, be gentle, for example, to your spouse. How many of you want to turn your husband to become your love slave? Master, yeah, my husband is the head, but you can be the neck to turn the head around. And how you can be the neck to turn your husband around? Gentleness. Man, you can make him, because you are gentle, your love slave man. And Colossians chapter 3 verse 19 says,
husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly.
In other words, be gentle, all right, to your wife. And I think it's also applied, be gentle to your husband. And in not just the volume of your voice, but the tone, your facial expression, if you're frowning all the time. And Proverbs 20 verse 3.
Avoiding a fight is a mark of honor. Only fools insist on quarreling.
Now, how many times you're almost tempted to explode? Man, I got to tell my wife the peace of my mind now. And every time you're tempted to explode, remember this verse. I memorize this verse because every time I tempted to explode, I remember this verse. It's avoiding a fight, being explosive, not being explosive, is a mark of honor. Not only keep yourself cool, it is honorable, and other people say. And next is gentle to your kids. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4.
And you, fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord.
One of the most powerful key in effective parenting is never to raise your voice. Because the very minute you raise your voice, number one, you lost control. Number two, it's self-defeating because they're not going to listen to you anyway. It's going to be the opposite, producing the opposite effect. Because as a matter of fact, they're going to become resentful. And be gentle also to your parents. I told the young people yesterday, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 2.
Respect your father and mother is the first commandment that has a promise added, so that all may go well with you and you may live a long time in the land.
To the young people in Vibrant Youth Service, when you are gentle, respectful to your parent, everything's going to go well. Your examination is going to be flying with colors. And you're going to live long. You're going to be healthy. Sit back, relax, and watch this clip.
What is that? A sparrow. What is that? I just told you, Father, it's a sparrow. What is that? A sparrow, Father, a sparrow. A sparrow. What is that? Why are you doing this? I've just told you so many times. It's a sparrow. Can't you get it? Where are you going? Read aloud.
Today, my younger son, who turned 3 a few days ago, was sitting with me at the park when a sparrow sat in front of us. My son asked me 21 times what it was, and I answered all 21 times that it was a sparrow. I hugged him every single time he asked me the same question, again and again, without getting mad, feeling affection for my innocent little boy.
To the young people, be gentle to your parents. Don't complain, Dad, you're so slow. Remember one day, you're not just slow, you're actually crawling. Be gentle to your spouse, gentle to your parents, gentle to your kids. Be gentle to the people that you try to reach out to. That's Peter chapter 2, verse 15.
And if someone asks about your Christian hope, always be ready to explain it. But do this in a gentle and respectful way.
How to become a powerful witness? One of the key way is to be gentle. Because when you are gentle, you become influential and you're going to be persuasive. Have you been to a lorong or a little street and where you want to buy something, but that guy come out and keep on talking, raise the voice, come on, buy this, come on, buy that. Actually, you want to buy that product because that guy is talking so much. So put off, you walk away, you ran away. Hey, some of us know, gentleness is persuasive. So when you try to reach out to people, don't talk all the time. Listen a little bit more and be gentle in what you say. And you're going to be persuasive. You're going to be influential, in other people say. Amen. Next, gentleness makes you beautiful and earns you respect. Look at Proverbs 11, verse 16.
A woman of gentle grace gets respect, but men of rough violence grab for loot.
Next translation.
A gracious woman attains honor.
How about I have more respect? So you always, I'm not respected. How about I have more respect? You want more honor? I heard of Mother Teresa. I mean, it's just a very diminutive elderly lady, and it's perhaps 4 feet and a half. But it, well, little lady walk into perhaps a hall. It could be the Congress. It could be the Parliament. It could be in the hall where they award Nobel Peace Prizes. People in awe because she hardly can speak audibly, but all eyes are on her. And her mouth is wide open to listen to every word that she speaks. She commands such respect. She commands such honor because this is a lady with immense gentleness and compassion. The kidding is, gentleness releases compassion. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 3.
Do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging the hair, wearing gold or putting on fine apparel.
Now, it doesn't mean that you don't wear jewelry. It doesn't mean that you don't wear good clothing. But it says here, do not let your adornment be merely. Continue.
Rather, let it be the hidden person of the heart with the incorruptible beauty of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is very precious in the sight of God.
Wow, God's eye, a gentle and a quiet spirit, not loudspeaker. is a person with incorruptible, unfading beauty. Put it this way, it is the best plastic surgery you can ever apply to yourself. Man, your face is going to shine. Your face is going to be lifted up with the best, better even than your Elizabeth, what, then? or Shiseido, whatever. It is the best spa you can ever get. Your face is going to be lifted up. You're going to have a glow on your face. Your eye will sparkle. Oh, man, not the wrinkle will be gone. The more you frown, the more you show black face, the more lines you're going to see on your face. The Bible tells us, as we allow that gentleness to permeate into life, it's going to release that unfading, incorruptible beauty. Next verse, verse 5.
For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands.
Well, Pastor, I agree totally to the verse, being submissive to their husband. Pastor, tell my wife to submit to me. Hey, if you're going to tell your wife to submit to you, you have just already lost that respect. I remember the respect is earned. How do we earn that respect? Gentleness. In the notes, I say, if you have to tell people to listen to you because you are the leader, that you are in charge, you have already lost your respect. Okay, so gentleness beautifies you, makes you beautiful, and earns you respect. Number five, gentleness releases supernatural intervention. Look at the Numbers of the 12. Talk about Miriam during a big fast.
Miriam and Aaron spoke against Moses because of the Cushite woman whom he had married, for he had married a Cushite woman. And they said, "Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also?" And the Lord heard it. Now, the man Moses was very meek, more than all people who were on the face of the earth. And suddenly, the Lord said to Moses and to Aaron and Miriam, "Come out, you three, to the tent of meeting."
Miriam, the other sister of Moses, threw a big fuss. The woman that Moses married, we don't know the background, whether it's the right thing to do or the wrong thing to do, but the fact is, it threw a big fuss, making a lot of noise. But the most amazing, the Bible tells us, Moses never answer a word, never make a defense, because the Bible tells us that Moses was the most meek man. The only two people that are labeled being described as meek, it is Moses and the Bible. And yet, astoundingly, Moses has a very violent temper. Remember that in the early days, he actually murdered somebody because he was angry. And because saw the people build the golden calf, he threw the stone. He's a guy like today, throwing handphone, throwing chairs, throwing plates when he's angry. And man, Moses was transformed. That means what? It means you have hope. Oh, Pastor, I'm born like that. I'm a very explosive person. It means you have hope. If Moses can be changed, we can be transformed. What is the key that really changed Moses? Put it this way, is this, that Moses was open to feedbacks and open to corrections. You notice how he reacted. It was not like just because one incident like that. It must have been a trait in Moses' life. That's how he deal with people that threw a big fuss. He just keep his mouth shut and be at rest. Pastor, like that, people will treat me like a doormat. Some people are, Pastor, very harsh, you know. They overcorrected me. If there's such a word. Or unfairly corrected me. Put it this way, as you rest, how many must know God is your defender? Look exactly what happened. God came down. Miriam, come out! And to cut the story short, Miriam was stricken with leprosy. For a short period of time, of course, there's grace involved. Put it this way, Moses was such a violent person. And because he opens himself to correction, look at Proverbs 13, verse 18.
Poverty and disgrace come to those who ignore discipline, but the one who accepts correction will be honored.
Wow, how many to be honored? How many to have more respect? You felt, you know, Pastor, my wife don't respect me. The key way to have more respect is to be gentle. You've got to be honored when you allow people to correct you without being offended, all right? Not get upset and angry, show your face when people correct you. And how many must some people are going to overcorrect me and unfairly correcting me. Put it this way, when you go to rest, how many must know God is your defense? And you know that the position of rest is a position of power. Say the position of rest, position of power. Look at Proverbs 16, verse 32.
He who is slow to anger is better than a mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes a city.
That's the position of power. When you are slow to anger, you rule, control your emotion, you're stronger than the person who takes a city. So, we see that gentleness is so powerful, bring you respect, brings you honor, neutralize your enemy, and releases divine intervention. Now, how do I express my gentleness? Number one, be gentle with people that God places about you. Be gentle with everybody, high and low. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 32.
Instead, be kind to each other, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, just as God, through Christ, has forgiven you.
Notice this here, be kind, be gentle to everybody. That means people higher than you, people lower than you. Hey, sometimes I would say display a very, very obnoxious attitude when we are at the dining table. Waiter, waitress is a bit slow. We demand, we raise our voice. Who gave us the right to shout at the waitresses just because you pay? The person. How many must know That is not the right attitude. And God wants us to be gentle with people higher up, people lower than us. So be gentle with waiters, waitresses, jaga gerita boys. Be gentle with all these people. Be at a counter, the shopping mall, they're slow a bit. You don't have to raise our voice. Just because you pay, it doesn't give you the right to demand. Same thing with the cafe. Just because you pay, it doesn't mean you can make a lot of noise at our cafe downstairs. Same with the volunteers in the Sunday school. Because some of us know, the very minute that we got to raise our voice, it shows that we're just not doing what God tells us to do. We've got to forfeit the amazing power that can be released. So be gentle with people high and low. And I told the young people, what is the most important key test to know whether that guy is a good person for you, whether that girl is a good person for you? Number one test, see how he treats not just people on the higher up, most important, whether he is kind to the people on the lower strata of society, whether he is generous and kind to people like waiter and waitresses, jaga gerita, behind the counter people. This is the key test, whether that person is the right spouse for you. That display real character, gentleness. Be gentle with people that are different. The next point, look at Romans chapter 14, verse 1.
Give a warm welcome to any brother who wants to join you, even though his faith is weak. Don't criticize him for having different ideas from yours about what is right and wrong.
That's just because you have a different thinking on matter, perhaps like drinking or smoking, a dress. Doesn't give you the right to make a lot of fuss. Be gentle. You may be right, even biblically, but humbleness though. 1 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 1 tells us,
knowledge puffs up, but love builds up.
See, the very minute that we puff up, become arrogant, because we are right, even though we are right, we lost our influence. You may be right and not influential. You may be right, but not persuasive. James chapter 3, verse 17.
But the wisdom from above is first of all pure. It is also peace-loving, gentle at all times, and willing to yield to others.
Gentle? That means we're willing to yield. I think it was St. Francis of Assisi who said, in the essentials, we have unity. In the non-essential, we have liberty. But in all things, we have charity. The word charity, of course, the old English word simply means love. That means we learn to agree to disagree. All right, in your notes, I say, even when you are disagreeing, you are respectful, not calling names. You are courteous. You are friendly. Now look at Ephesians chapter 4. It's a very interesting passage. Ephesians 4, verse 30.
And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. You must put away every kind of bitterness, anger, wrath, quarreling, and evil, slanderous talk.
Now, how do we grieve the Holy Spirit? A lot of time we think, oh man, this brother, the way she wear, she, some people you don't know, they are wrongly dressed, some people are underdressed, like a stock market, but you, the cotton gone down in price, they're underdressed, man. But, hey, grieving the Holy Spirit got nothing to do with how you dress, what do you eat. It's the word that we speak in our mouth. It says here, do not grieve the Holy Spirit by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption, and you must put away every kind of bitterness, anger, wrath, quarreling, and evil, slandering talk. The way that we can actually grieve the Holy Spirit is through the words in our mouth. And it, for example, demeaning words, even behind the back. Yeah, he's a real idiot. Man, he's an elephant, he's a donkey, he's stupid. Hey, how much when you do that, even behind the back, you just insulted someone that has been created in God's image. And you grieve the Holy Spirit. Now, what do you mean by grieving the Holy Spirit? It means to make the Holy Spirit sad. Why is the Holy Spirit sad when we speak all those negative words? He is sad because he cannot do a greater work in your life. He wanted to bless you more, but he couldn't because of that attitude. He wanted to extend his favor upon you in greater measure, but he couldn't. He's held back because we grieve him, make him sad. He couldn't do a greater work because he is there to seal the blessing of God in our life. He says here, in whom you were sealed. When I talk about seal, what do you think of? It's quality. or you buy an electrical product, you make sure you have serim. There's a measure of protection. That is that quality that you know, Malaysian standard is good quality. Now, put it this way, it grieves the Holy Spirit is because when we speak negative things behind people's back, he's a chicken, he's a dog, he's this and that. Hey, it affects that quality that is on the inside of you because God wants us to shine with his grace, but the Holy Spirit is not able to complete his work in your life because you've got to lose that shine. All right? And just when you criticize a person for a particular thing, you find that in another way, you can be at fault. So the key thing is, Hamra must know, we avoid that grieving of the Holy Spirit by putting our focus on what God says, that we want to be gentle at all times. And other people say, amen. Be gentle with those that disappoint you. Galatians 6 verse 1.
Brothers, if someone is caught in a sin, you who are spiritual should restore him gently. But watch yourself, or you also may be tempted.
Be gentle with those that mess up their life. Sort of saying to them, I told you so, you have to listen to me. We don't get harsh with them. Why? Because watch out, it says so. Watch yourself, or you may also be tempted. I may not be tempted in a particular area that I may be criticized with, but you may be tempted in another area. And when you criticize people that they've given in a particular area, one day, when you are struggling with another area, you may be in need of that same grace that you wanted to withdraw from that person. The key thing is, you may really need that grace. So be gentle with those people that disappoint you. Okay, how to release that gentleness? Speaking the truth in love. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 24.
The Lord's servant must gently teach those who disagree. Then maybe God will let them change their minds so that they can accept the truth. And they may wake up and escape from the trap of the devil who catches them to do what he wants.
And another translation said the devil can help them captive to do his will. We don't want people to be held captive to do his will. But sometimes we contribute that by being harsh. Because he is to be gentle, even if it's to correct, we correct with gentleness. Why? Because when we correct with gentleness, we could see that we could release life. Look at Proverbs 15 verse 4.
Gentle words are a tree of life. A deceitful tongue crushes the spirit.
Wow. When we speak gentle words, we can bring hope, we can bring life. And Ephesians 4 verse 15 says,
instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way more and more like Christ, who is the head of his body, the church.
Now, what happens when we speak the truth in love? Now, to be gentle doesn't mean that we don't discipline. All right? It doesn't mean you don't discipline your kids. It doesn't mean you don't discipline your husband. No, of course. It means we got to correct, but we got to correct with love. All right? It says, instead, we will speak the truth in love, growing in every way, more and more like Christ. In other words, when we speak the truth in love, you got to see that there's going to be growth in our life. You know, in the Bible, there's a passage in 1 Samuel chapter 2, verse 29. There was a guy, his name was Eli, not the Cantonese Eli. Eli, second wife, no. There's another Eli, and he got two sons. The son did behave well, very extremely corrupted. But the Bible tells us Eli never corrected the son. The reason he didn't correct his son is because the Bible says that Eli honored the son more than honor God. He's afraid to discipline. He's afraid to speak into the son's life. He's afraid to discipline the son. Look at the result. He lost the two sons, and he, of course, he himself died. The tragic death, untimely death. How many of us know that we got to correct? But the Bible has a way we got to correct gently. And how do we correct gently? We correct gently with love. How do we correct in love? Look at the passage in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 2.
Always be humble and gentle. Be patient with each other, making allowance for each other's fault because of your love.
How do we correct in love? All right, we've got to give allowance. Say, give allowance. How do we give allowance? Give people time to change. Pastor, I just told him to change it. Still like that? Hey, come on, even the dog. You got to train him a few times, all right? So, plus, he always forgets. Yeah, even the dog got to be reminded. how much more human being? So give people time to change. Number two, accept them as they are with love, and then you correct. So we say, oh, pastor, my husband changed first, then only I accept him. Oh, my son changed first, then only I accept. No, the Bible says you got to accept them first. When you accept them first and expressing love, man, you got to be able to correct and correct with influence and correct with persuasive power. That's what love is all about. That's agape love. Love for people. So, pastor, my husband don't deserve it. My colleague don't deserve it. Exactly. Agape love means love for people who didn't earn that love. Love for people that don't even deserve that love. Agape love origin not in the person being loved, in the person loving. That's God's kind of love. That's how He loves us. Not because we deserve it, not because we earn it, but because He is love. And we love because He first loved us. Oh, Pastor, He doesn't deserve my love. Exactly. Isn't that how deserving is Him? We love because He first loved us. Mother Teresa has an amazing ministry with his sisters. But every morning, they would pray this amazing prayer. Lord, make me worthy. Minister to these people. So they was very amazed. Why do you pray this prayer? These are the people that Mother Teresa, you're ministering to are the poorest of the poor in the streets of Calcutta. What do you mean every day you got to pray? Make me worthy to serve them. Inevitably, Mother Teresa would say, I see Jesus in the eyes of the poorest of the poor. Now people around about you, you feel they don't deserve it. You feel they don't earn that respect. But you respect them anyway. You obey them anyway. You accept them anyway. And that is love. And humble must know that is going to bring astounding, persuasive power in your life. Amazing, influential power in your life. Okay, next is how do we correct in love? Discern the right timing and the right place. Surely you're not going to correct your husband in front of everybody in the dining table. You make the throw a big fuss. Because you're not being nice. Don't correct your kids in public. Never do that. Don't correct your employee in public. You know, you pay the guy. Doesn't give you the right to embarrass that person in front of everybody. That's not gentleness. All right? So discern the right time and the right place. And even the doctor would, you know, before they operate, I hope, they would check your blood, make sure you're in the right condition. Otherwise, you put in the operating theater, he go in alive, come out dead because he's not ready for the operation. His blood condition is bad. He could have been given some vitamin A, B, C, D, and Z to build his body up. Some people, they're not ready. You've got to correct with time, in time. Feed them with the Word of God first. The right time come. God will give us the peace. And we correct with gentleness. We're going to see there's going to be that tremendous influential power and possessive power. Okay, so gentleness is so powerful, and who are we going to release that gentleness? Lastly, how do we develop gentleness? Let God work inside out. Say, God works inside out. Matthew 11:28.
Then Jesus said, come to me, all of you who are weary and carry heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy to bear, and the burden I give you is light.
Come down to me, and I'll give you rest, the Bible says. You know, what's the reason why we are not gentle? Because the main reason, let me tell you this, is self. If it's going to be, it's up to me. If I don't push, if I'm not aggressive, if I don't scream, don't I show face, even raise my voice, I cannot get things done. So from young, we learn from young. You got to cry, you got to scream. Mom and dad come to the rescue. And you have people that have overgrown babies today. They still scream, they still shout, they still show blackface. Because I think that is the way to get things done. Because early days, when you scream, mama come, papa come, and now grandfather come. If not grown out of that. It's all about self. This is why we get frustrated. Jesus Christ said, be happy, be gentle. And the good is because of yourself. The good is come to Jesus. As we come to Jesus, He will give us His rest. Why is it important to rest? Because gentleness is a fruit. It's not work. You say, oh, Pastor, this year, I think since talk about gentleness, I focus on gentleness. Next year only, I talk about love. Next year, third year, I plan already. Third year, I develop kindness. No, cannot. The fruit. They say the fruit of the Holy Spirit is a fruit with 9 flavors. And one of which, the key one, is gentleness. In other words, it's a fruit. You cannot fake gentleness. You cannot force gentleness. Because of the inside job, Galatians 5, verse 22.
But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
So, it's a fruit. You got to let God develop. It is a product of God. You know, sometimes we buy a shirt, we want to look at the back and see if it is made in where, you know? It's like electrical product. Wow, made in Germany is a whole. When's a good one? Going to be in somewhere? Oh, wait. Careful, better don't buy. And the point is that when God look at us, when people look at us, when they see the harshness, they see the crudeness, they know it's not made in heaven. It's the work of the flesh. But when they look at you and see, man, you are gentle under stress, and you shine with a sparkle in your eye in the midst of challenges, people of the world will look at you and say, made in heaven, product of the Holy Spirit. Now, if it is a product of the Holy Spirit, it is a fruit, then you're going to have seeds. What is a seed? The Word of God. You got to govern your life, not based upon your feeling, but govern your life based upon the Word of God. This is why we need to get into the Word. And then we got to shine. How do we shine? Look at Jesus. The more you see Jesus, how many of us know, the more you got to shine. The Bible, as you behold Him, you're going to be transformed. See Him. The Bible tells in the book of Songs, He's altogether lovely. So you're going to be, He is altogether lovely. Man, he's like a perfectly cut diamond. No matter how you look at him, he shines with brilliance. Human being. This is why we get upset, very angry, not gentle, because we look at human being to supply our deepest need. Even the best of human being is not going to totally satisfy you. So look at your husband to satisfy the deepest need. Look at your spouse to satisfy the deepest need. You're going to be frustrated. And then you have unexplained anger. Pastor, I don't know why I'm so angry. The reason because you're so angry for nothing is because you expect a human being to fulfill your deepest need. Where God is standing there alongside you, your paraclete, wanting to fulfill your deepest needs. Because the only person in this world that can satisfy your deepest need is Jesus Christ Himself, because He is altogether lovely, and all the people say. He's perfectly balanced. No unevenness. He is strong. Amazingly strong, but gentle. Remember in the Garden of Gethsemane, they come and they want to take him? We're looking for Jesus. The soldiers, strong, muscle bulging, bicep, tricep, quadriceps. We're not looking for Jesus. Jesus gently said, I am. Boom, 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 boom. All of them fell down. That's power. And then this Peter took his sword and sliced off the ear of the soldier. Jesus took the year and put it back and heal. Let me tell you this, that soldier will remember this for life. Every time the father say, or mother or the wife say, dinner, he knows, he can hear, because the man that he came to slaughter heal him. If everyone, he listen to music, Mozart or Handel's, the sweet voices of the music, he remember, there was this guy, I came to arrest, but he healed me. Jesus, strong but gentle. As you see him, you're going to be transformed. He was bold. I mean, he correct people. It's not that he doesn't correct. He looked at the Pharisee and he said, you whitewashed tomb. And he looked at Peter and he said, Satan, get behind me. He's not a wimp. All right? But yet, the woman caught in the very act of adultery, he said, neither do I condemn you, go and sin no more. He is bold, but filled with grace, not harsh at all. Why do you think Jesus can say, neither do I condemn you, because he's going to be condemned. He's going to take our place, number one. Number two, Jesus understands the power of grace. Condemnation kills, but how many must know, grace brings life. Jesus, bold but gracious. It's altogether lovely. He was meek, he was humble, but is full of majesty and regality. Remember they spit on him? They mocked him, prophesied, tell us of our name, you prophets. Spit on him. They lash him with a whip, mock him with a crown, say you're a king now, you got to rise up, defend yourself. For us, a human being, you know, sometimes we are very gentle, sometimes we explode. I've seen people like that. Man, people like that treat us. We throw stone, we throw handphone, throw chairs. But Jesus was meek. But when he was meek, he was still filled with majesty and regality. When Pilate wanted to sentence him, he was afraid. He looked at that face that has been disfigured, that has been marred beyond recognition. Pilate, a seasoned Roman soldier, withdrew in fear. He said, I don't know who this person is. Behold the man. That rugged centurion that plunged that spear right to the side of Jesus. And at the time, he was beyond human recognition. He plunged the spear. That rugged Roman soldier looked at him and say, hey, this must be the Son of God. Despite he was so meek, he was filled with such awesome majesty, regality. Let me put it this way. Only Jesus can be Jesus. If you look at man, you're going to be disappointed. That's the reason why you got frustrated. You're not gentle because you look at man. But look at Jesus. How many must know? You're going to be transformed. You let Jesus' word control your life. That seed, how many must know, is going to produce fruit. And other people say, Pastor, I struggle with this. I'm just not a gentle person. Let me tell you this, you have hope because you have Jesus. The more you behold him, let God's word take root. The seed will produce that fruit. It's not you try to do it. It's the product of the Holy Spirit. It's the fruit of the Holy Spirit. The more you behold him, the more you see Jesus, you're not to grieve him. You're going to not make him sad. He wants to do more things in your life. It's not that you say a mean thing, then you lose your salvation. No, your salvation is assured. But the Holy Spirit would be grieved because he wants to do more work in your life. He couldn't because he has just lost that shine. Because he wants to put that seal upon you, that seal of that quality. But you lose it because of that, grieving the Spirit. But what you need to do is to behold him. The more you see Jesus, man, you're going to be transformed. One of the most powerful ways to see Jesus is to take what he did for you 2,000 years ago. We'd like to close, give an opportunity for those of you who have not known Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, to say this prayer. Would you join together with me to receive Christ into your life? Say together with me, Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for me on the cross. Right now, I receive him as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, and all of you will scream. There is
no fear. If you have said that prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to RLC at oasisofcare.org. That is RLC at OASISOFCARE.ORG.